Yeah.
Yeah. See, between MR1 and MR2, okay. In MR1, the map reducer now will run on slots. Map run reducer. Okay, so
Correct.
whatever job you have to write, it has to be in map reduce format. Okay, but when it comes to YARN, you can write your language, you can choose your language, and YARN will help us to do the conversion and run the map reduce on the background.
Correct.
Okay, now this mapper and slots, reduces slots. Okay, basically it depends on the art core that we design for the server.
Okay.
Okay, but in the YARN, it is more of a container base, right? Inside the container, the mapper and reducers will come in, and it is dynamically allocated.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm just wondering how this calculation will happen. So, for example, I have 10 jobs. In MR1, when you submit a job, it will calculate all the resources required for that job, and it will reserve, whether it is use it or not, it has to reserve before its execution. But in YARN, it will do it on the execution time.
Okay, so the here you will predefine the the slot memory, right? Say for example, for each slot you configure 1 GB memory, right?
Yeah.
Whereas yeah, say for example, in one machines you have configured 6 slots, 3 for map reduce and map task and 3 for reduce task. Okay, say for example, you are running a job and it is launching 4 map tasks. But in one, let's say we have only one node, okay? But okay, the jobs are 4. Sorry, the map tasks are 4, but you have configured only 3 map tasks. Slots, right? That means the first 3 map tasks will be picked up and it will be running. The second one will wait. This will not be scheduled on the reduce slot. Okay.
Yeah,
so
right.
whereas in YARN, right? What we do is we will not fix the slot.
Correct.
Instead, what we will do is we will for each task we will set okay, this is the minimum memory required to run the job. Say for
Correct.
Example, let's say we have 6 GB.
Correct.
Okay, and let's say we have four map tasks and 1 reduce task. Okay, now what will happen is since we have not fixed anything with respect to slot or anything, right? So all the 4 map tasks will be launched. Let's assume that I am configuring 1 GB is the minimum memory that is needed to execute one task. Okay, here it is launching 4 map tasks. I have 6 GB memory free for running the task. Okay, so and I have not specified any slot for map or reduce task. Okay, since I have a memory for running this 4 map tasks. Okay, okay, all the 4 map tasks will be launched immediately.
Correct.
Okay, and once that is done, then again we'll be having more spaces. Okay, I mean we'll be having more memory for running the reduce task. In fact, the reduce task might occupy 1 GB or 2 GB, doesn't matter, still we will be having the memory. So basically you are setting only the minimum memory which is needed to execute the task in YARN, whereas there will be setting the fixed one. Okay, this is the amount it has to use. Even say for example,
but I understand clearly, I know this concept. My question is this heap size allocation. This heap memory, okay, needs to be allocated for the container as well, right? So there is some method to do that heap allocation. So I'm just wondering how to do that heap allocation. Because
I'm getting disturbance here.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, come again.
My question is, what is the heap size that we need to define, whether it is minimum or maximum, it depends on the task that is going to run.
Yeah.
Fine, but there should be some method to even given a minimum EAP size for a container should be calculated, correct?
Yeah, right. So that's what it is configurable. It is configurable in the YANA if you cited example, right? There you will specify the minimum, heap size memory.
I'm just asking memory allocation for the container, minimum memory allocation for the container, how will you calculate that minimum memory is required for that container? So there is some method to be defined. Because I tell you one scenario. So I was using YARN, okay, I was doing in 4.7, I believe, 4 years back. And I was running jobs, okay. Few jobs will run, few jobs will not run. I was struggling it for almost more than a week to fix it up, but nothing was working on. Then I called the Cloudera and they also tried many number of times changing the heap memory and all those things, and nothing was.
What was the memory size you kept it?
That is a MR1 only, not YARN.
Oh, MR. Okay, MR1. But you are not sure about the memory heap size, right?
I gave up to 10 GB also. But it was failing. I add the hard code value in the ENV file, which is by default coming in the old version. So it was having 256 MB. So that was the issue, I know that. But when you're using MR1, you need to be very careful when you define the CPU memory.
Correct, yeah.
Because
see, the amount of memory that you are setting, will be determined based on the block size as well. Say for example, even though n number of jobs running in the cluster, maybe I can explain this way. Say for example, your block size is 256 MB, right? You know that input spec concept, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So for each input spec, one map task will be assigned. Okay. Let's assume that one particular map task is launched to process 256 MB of data. Mm-hmm. Okay. In that cases, right? So this is one task, right? Okay. So job is different from the task. Okay. Job will be divided into n number of tasks. Okay. So and this all these tasks will be running in different machines in the real cluster. Okay. Mm-hmm. So this one particular task, okay, it's not going to process maximum more than when I say 256, it can maximum process 260 or 265 MB of data. One task will process, right?
But in case if you have 128 MB that time when I was using it,
then it could be a different issue.
It will run up to 3/4 of the job. After that, only it will fail.
Okay. Yeah. This is the formula.
I know that. But still, even in YARN, you need to define the minimal heap memory size for the containers.
Definitely, you need to define that minimum one. Okay. See, say for example, if your block size is 256, you cannot give 256 MB RAM for the heap memory. Okay. Instead, you have to give the double the amount, or at least the minimum is 1 GB is the ideal one. Minimum 1 GB is the ideal one. Okay, so that 1 GB of RAM is capable of handling 256 MB of data, and also sometimes it might put the process data back in the in memory like during the partitions in the MapReduce, right? It might hold some portion of process data before it is spilling into the local file system. So I would say 1 GB is more than enough to handle the 256 MB of block. But I don't know exactly what error you got in version. Do you have that exception detail with you?
No, I don't have it now. What it shows is it is showing out of heap memory.
Yeah, in fact, it could be a different reason even in Hadoop environment. I tell you one more problem that I faced recently in Spark. Okay, I know everybody knows Spark runs in memory, right? I mean, it can be configured such a way it can run in memory as well as in disk, right? So it can be set up in three ways. Either it can run only in memory, or it can run only in disk, or it can run in memory as well as in disk. So what happened is, when we started this Spark very first time, we did not give the configuration properties in R. Just for that, it was throwing memory out of exception. Spark.
Now, where you didn't mention that memory size?
I'm sorry?
Now, you said you didn't mention somewhere, right? What is that?
No. Command, right? The Spark command.
Okay.
Spark, when you submit the Spark action, right? So what happened is we didn't specify the properties in order. Like say for example, you will add the dependency files, IP9.5, then you will give all the dependency files like property files. You can specify the property files and everything. So what happened is we gave this jar file before this files in order. Okay. Just for that, it was running in a client mode perfectly, but when we ran that in a cluster mode, it was throwing memory out of exception. Like the heap memory out of encryption. So we thought like it's memory issue, memory issue. Then we took small amount of data, again it was throwing the same memory out of use. Then we contacted, we created a ticket for this. It was like changing the mirror and something. He just changed the order, okay? He just placed the -5 before the adding the dependency jar. Then it started working. Yeah, even for unknown user, it will be giving a memory out of exception or read size error. Okay, yes, in version 1, right, it was the early stage. Right, Hadoop version 1 was a failure model. Most company did not adapt to that one, right? So yeah. Even for small things, right, they have given some this kind of exceptions. That's, you might have faced those type of exception failure. Even still, we face the memory out of exception in Spark, even though it is not memory related issues.
Okay.
Yeah. By chance, if you get those exceptions, then I can check it
out.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. We will talk about this number of slat and how do we set up them. Yes. Okay. So far we have seen how Hadoop stores and retrieves the data in HDFS, right? So from now on, our focus is going to be only on processing, right? So in version 1, Hadoop has two primary components. First one is HDFS, which takes care of storing the data, and the second component is MapReduce, which takes care of processing the data, right? So what is MapReduce? Right? What is MapReduce? MapReduce is the programming model for processing the data in parallel. Okay, it's a programming model. Right. So it's a programming model for processing the large data sets in parallel, and MapReduce can process the data which is stored only in HDFS. MapReduce cannot process the data which is stored outside HDFS. Okay, I will explain why. Okay, but MapReduce can be used to transfer the data from outside to HDFS. Good example is Scoop. Scoop is it's a tool for transferring the data from RDBMS to Hadoop environment. In fact, Scoop internally uses MapTask to transfer the data from RDBMS to Hadoop environment. So that's why I'm telling. So MapReduce can process the data which is stored only in HDFS. Once again, yeah, I'm getting called. Okay, it cannot process the data which is stored outside HDFS. Is it clear? Okay. MapReduce has two phases. Okay. Map phase and reduce phase. You can see map phase and reduce phase. Okay. So before that, I just want to explain this. What does that mean parallel here? Can someone explain? Maybe except Arvind, I'm sure you are into Hadoop for more than 4 years. Anyone other than Arvind?
Like what I know is like map is the one place where we'll be inputting the values and reduce will be like processing the output. So which means I can put on.
Well, what does that mean parallel here? I said like nothing, MapReduce is nothing but it's just a program. Okay, it's a concept. Okay, MapReduce is one algorithm. That's its concept. So very simple, it's a program. Okay, but so that program will be used for processing the data which is stored in the HDFS. But the thing is, the beauty of MapReduce is it will run in parallel.
So simultaneously, multiple nodes processing different blocks.
Correct. Exactly. Maybe let me explain this way. Just want to explain this. For example, let's say you have a 1 GB of either file or table in high. Okay, let's say either file or table, this is HDFS. Okay, let's assume that this is a high table. Again, data will be stored in the HDFS only. Okay, don't get confused. Let's say you have a 1 GB of file or 1 GB of table. Now, as you know, so whenever we copy the file into Hadoop system, it will be broken into blocks, right? Let's assume that, let's say the default block size is 256. Not default is 128. Let us assume that we are going to have 256 MB. Okay, we are going to configure the default block size as 256 MB. Okay, does it mean how many blocks will be having for this 1 GB file?
4.
Yeah, 4. So this we have the 256, 256, 256, 256. Same, let's say table also will be divided into blocks, right? Now, you need to understand the difference between sequential processing and parallel processing. I know people who are from the application side will be understanding this one, even from the device, but just want to cover for Sujata and some other people who are from the testing side, okay? Okay. Sequential processing versus processing. Okay, if you process this 1 GB of file or 1 TB of table, okay, using a sequential method, what will is it will launch one process. That process will process one by one, right? It will first process this block. Again, it will process the same thread will be processing the second block, third block, and fourth block. Let us assume that to process this, the first block takes 10 minutes. Okay, means if you launch only single thread to process the entire 1 GB of file, it will take 10 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes, and totally 40 minutes. It will take 40 minutes. Okay, so instead of processing this file using a single thread, if you launch multiple thread, what will happen? Okay, let's assume that you are going to write a program or query to process the file or table. Let's say in case of file, you'll write a program. In case of table, you'll write a query, right? So you have written a one query and you are passing this to process. Okay, now you are, let's assume that you are passing the same query or program, okay, to the multiple location wherever the blocks resides, okay, and you are asking that those threads to run simultaneously at the same time. As I said, a single thread will take 10 minutes to process 256 MB. Okay, now you have launched four thread to process this 1 GB of file. It means that so all this 1 GB file will be processed in 10 minutes because you have launched four thread to process the block simultaneously, right? That means it will take only 10 minutes. So after 10 minutes, it may take even 2 or 3 minutes to consolidate the data because data is split across multiple blocks, right? So we have to consolidate and produce the final output. So for that, it may take 2 or 3 minutes. Okay, totally it won't take more than 30 minutes. So this is the beauty of MapReduce. Okay, so it basically MapReduce runs in parallel. Okay, it basically processes the block in parallel. Is this clear? The difference between cycle processing and parallel processing?
Prakash, can you just tell once the parallel processing?
I'm sorry?
No. Oh, can you just explain again? So I understood sequential. Can you just explain again parallel processing?
Okay. Let's say you have written some program, okay, in Java or something, whatever, any language that you prefer, okay. So you are passing the same program to the, let's say, you have, this is the data node, okay, and each node holds one set of block. Block 1 is here, block 3 is here, block 4 is here, block 2 is here, okay. So what MapReduce will be doing is, okay, let's say you have written one program to process data. So this MapReduce will pass the same program to all the places. The same program will be passed to all the places. Okay, and all this program will be running parallelly here. So let's say this program takes 10 minutes to process this block. Okay, that means since all this, you know, processes are running simultaneously, everything will take 10 minutes. Okay, so all the processing will be done within 10 minutes. Now is it clear?
Yeah, got it. Thanks.
Yeah, so instead of passing one program to process one by one, once this is completed, then it will go here, it will complete, then again it will go here, it will complete, then again it will go here and there. So you are passing the same program to all the places simultaneously. And it will be running in parallel. Okay.
Prakash, like these four blocks, what you told, that they came under a name node or they came under data node? You told like data node, right? So.
Yeah, data node holds the actual data, not the name node, right? So okay. The program will be okay. Let me explain on a high level. Okay, so. Basically, HTTPS works by breaking the large files into number of blocks, right? And each block will be, okay, so basically, files broken into blocks, right? And each block will be moved to different data nodes. So this is storage part, right? Now in the processing part, we have in version 1, we have a job tracker. Okay, I'll be explaining job tracker. What job tracker will do? Job tracker will pass the program to all the place where the data reside, right? Then it will ask task tracker to process the data. Basically, task tracker will be running the program. Okay, task tracker TT, okay, will run the program basically to process the data. So once process is done, then data will be given to, okay, data will be stored back in HTTPS itself. Okay. So this is okay. So when you copy the file, the files will be broken into blocks, and each block will be moved to different data nodes. Now, when it comes to processing part, okay, processing part, job tracker will pass the program. Program is nothing but you have written the program. Okay, so you are going to write the program. So you will have the logic on how to process the data. So basically, you are going to write the program, okay, and you will submit the program. So job tracker will take it up, passing the program to the place wherever the data resides, and the task tracker will run the program to process the data. So once the data is processed, the same data will be processed to data, we can say, processed to data. will be stored back in HDFS. Okay, so on high level I'm just explaining. Okay, I'll just explain in detail. Got it? So this is how the processing is done, storage and processing done. Okay. Yeah.
You said multi-threading, right? So multi-threading mean single thread in a single node, or in a single node you say multiple threads?
When I say multiple parallel, right, in a cluster, right? Okay, just let me, okay, you can visualize this like this. In version 1, we had a name node and job tracker. These are all called name node, job tracker. Okay, so here in version 1, we have a data node. We call this as data node and task tracker. Data node and task tracker. Okay, here name node, data node takes care of storing. Job tracker and task tracker takes care of processing. Okay, so at any point of time in version 1, you can have only one name node and one job tracker. And similarly, per data node, you can per node we can have only one data node, one task tracker only. Okay, so this data node holds the actual data. This task tracker is nothing but just, you know, it's a daemon service. Okay. Which will be listening to job tracker, okay. And say, for example, whenever job tracker assigns some task to task tracker will do the job. Basically, it will do the task, okay. Say, for example, let me put it this way, okay. Job and task. How do I give you example on this part? Job is nothing but let's say I have room, okay, where I have placed around 100 books, okay, and I have another room, okay. Now I'm getting a assignment to transfer all these 100 books to another room, okay. We can call this as one job. So the job is to transfer the 100 books from this room to this room. Okay, task is nothing but moving the books from here to there is called task. So for example, let's say you are giving this job to 5 people, okay, and each person should carry 20 books from here and move it to here. Okay, so each person doing some task, right? So they are moving, they are collecting this book from 20 books from here and moving to these locations. So that is what we call as a task. So each person doing something, right, that is called as task. The job is moving the 100 books from here to there is called a job. Okay, the task is the each person is doing that is moving the 20 books from here to there. Clear? So that's what I am referring to, job and task. Okay, so the job, okay, job is nothing but, you know, here let's assume the job tracker. Okay, he is the master node. He is responsible for assigning the task to the task tracker. Okay, here, okay, job is, we have the job, but someone will be assigning the job to the people, right? Okay, we have 5 person, right? Some will be having one master here. One person will be, say, for example, let's say manager, project manager, and team member, right? So manager will assign the task to the team member, and the team member will do the task. Clearly, so task tracker can be referred to team member, job tracker can be referred to technical manager.
So in this case, you say like we have 4 data nodes, for example. So you say multi-threading. So it runs only 4 threads, 4 multiple threads to process the whole data. Is that so?
Here, right, I have submitted one program. Okay, what job tracker will do is, we have written only one program. We are not going to write different 4 programs to process different 4 blocks. Okay, just one program. Job tracker will pass this program to the task tracker, and it will ask the task tracker to run the program against the data stored in this data node. Okay, it will happen simultaneously. Okay, at the same time it will ask all the transactor to run the program to run the against the data it holds. Clear?
Yeah, okay.
So the same program will be copied once here, 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 here. Okay. So once the program is copied in all the places, okay, it will now instruct all the task tracker simultaneously. Hey, run this program against the data that you have. Okay, it will send the instruction simultaneously. Okay, it will send the instruction to all the task trackers. Run the program against the data that you have, and all the task tracker will be running in parallel. Let's say it has instructed 10 a.m. Okay, everyone will start 10, 11 something a.m. Okay, everyone will start at the same time 10, 11, 10, 11, 10, 11, right? So and everyone will finish by 10:21. So the amount of time you have taken here is just 10 minutes to process all the 4 blocks. Even though it is 1 GB of data, it has taken only 10 minutes to process data because of parallel processing. In case of sequence processing, it has to process here first. It will take 10 minutes. Again, after once this is done, it will go here. It will process. Again, it will take another 10 minutes. Once this is done, then again it will go here. Again, it will take 40 minutes to process the 1 GB of file. Because of the parallel processing, it will finish the entire job in 10 minutes. Clear?
Yes, Prakash.
Yeah. How about others?
Yeah, Prakash, understood.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so yeah. So that's all. So it's a programming for processing the large data set in parallel. As I said, MapReduce has two pieces, map phase and reduce phase. So in fact, MapReduce follows a data model in which data is represented as a key value pair. Okay. So what is key value pair? I'm sure if you have some Java background, I'm sure you know very well what is key value pair, right? Anybody from Java background?
It's just hash maps.
Yeah, hash map follows key value pair concept, right? So key value pair is nothing but it's two set of linked data items. Here, key is unique identifier. Data. Here, key is unique identifier to the data. Values, nothing but the actual data. Data are located, reference to the location of data at least, right? So MapReduce is designed such a way it can work with key value pair. Now you can ask me why does MapReduce use key value pair to process the data? In fact, in MapReduce, right, MapReduce basically will receive the input as a key value pair and produce the output in a key value pair. I'm wrong. Basically, as I said, we have two phases, right? Map phase and reduce phase. So map phase will receive the data in a key value pair and produce the output in a key value pair. And reduce will receive the data in a key value pair. Basically, output of MapReduce map phase will be the input to the reduce phase. Okay, so reduce will receive the data from the map phase in a key value pair, and it produces the final output. Okay, so map is the stage where you will process the data. Reduce is the stage where you will consolidate the final output. Clear? So here it follows the key value pair. Now you can ask me, okay, why does it follow key value pair concept? Okay, let us say we have a customer transaction data, right? Let me. We have a customer transaction data, okay, and it's split across four blocks, okay. Now, say for example, I have a soil, right? Okay, now I want to, filter only soil records from these transactions, okay? Now, or at least I want to know, okay, which customer has bought more products, especially. Particularly on this day, today, right? So, or at least I want to filter the records belongs to Sai. Okay, okay. Sai, let's say Sai has done a lot of transactions today. Okay, and that means his record might be split across multiple blocks. Let's say this block has some records, Sai records, and this has nothing. Here we have records belongs to Sai, and this has one record. Okay. Now, let's, I told you, right? So the MapReduce will run in parallel. Okay, let's say one process running this, blocks in process this blocks in parallel and produce output two records. And here we have two records, and here it produces one record. Now I need to have at least one unique identifier which can help us to consolidate Sai records. How do I identify this record belongs to Sai? Right. So that is why MapReduce uses key value pair concept. Okay, here key can be used as a customer ID, and the value can be used as the entire record, entire row, right? So for example, how do we consolidate the records spilled across multiple blocks? Okay, if I by using this customer ID, I can consolidate all the records belong to Sai. This is clear. So that's the reason it MapReduce needs a key to identify the data uniquely. We'll not be having only Sai records. We'll be having RAM records, GRU records, etc. Keys were etc. Right?
Okay. This key is defined automatically, or we have to define it?
Okay. Key we have to define. Okay. Anyway, I'm going to explain how data will be represented in a key value pair to the map and reduce task. Okay. As I already told you, right, I have divided MapReduce into two parts, basic and advanced. Okay. So for now, I'm going to cover only the basic thing. After covering big, then I'll be taking the advanced one.
Okay.
There I will explain each and every key level. Like, we have different type of input format, like key text input format, key value text input format, inline text input format, whole input format, XML input format, etc. I don't want to confuse now. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Prakash, one small thing. You said like map will be giving an output and reduce will be taking that as an input, right? Which means like when you said about some parallel processing. So it is sequential processing. It is the reduce work is to only consolidate the outputs, right? Suppose
correct,
there
yeah,
are four nodes.
Yeah, map and reduce task cannot be run in parallel. Okay, only the map task will be running in parallel. Once all the map tasks have been completed, then only the reduce task will be launched.
Then basically the job of reduce is to consolidate the output of the map.
Correct, correct. Yes.
Okay.
That's
okay.
What, right? Here my requirement use case is to I want to find out all the records belong to Sai. Okay. And the Sai record is spilled across multiple blocks. It is Sai records are stored in three blocks, right? So the first I can run map task in parallel. So all the map tasks will give the Sai outputs. But I need some process which can consolidate the output, right? So that is where the Redis space comes into the picture. So Redis is responsible for consolidating this output.
Fine.
Yeah. So basically, yeah. So this map task will emit two records. This will emit zero records because there are no records, right, for psi here. Okay, this map task will emit two. This map task will emit four. And what happened is, Redis task will collect all the records from all the map tasks and produce the final output. It will give five records. So it is the responsibility of Redis task to consolidate the output. The important is map and Redis cannot run in parallel. Map thread will be invoked only when all the map tasks have been completed. This is one cloud or certification question.
Sorry, what is that question, Prakash?
Okay, when will Redis method be triggered? There will be multiple options. Okay, the actual answer is Redis method will be invoked only when all the map tasks have been completed. Okay, for example, you can ask, okay, why is it so? Okay, let's say this has completed. Okay, it has given two records. This is still processing. Okay, this is still processing. For some reason, it takes time, and this has processed and gives one. Okay, let's say now if I start Redis task, right, it will give only three records. Still, there are two records, right? This will be missed out. So that's the reason this Redis method will be invoked only after all the map tasks have been completed. But Redis phase will be started as soon as one map task has been completed. So map has some set of stages, and Redis has some set of stages. Let me explain this.
Okay, Prakash, okay, they say if one map task is completed, immediately Redis will start.
Yeah, Redis phase will be started, but Redis method will not be triggered.
Okay.
So under map Redis, on map phase, we have an input split. These are the different stages. Input split. We have a map method will be launched. Partition, sort, and split, compiler. In Redis space, we have a shuffle. We have shuffle, then sort, merge, and Redis method, and Redis. Okay, so these are the different stages we have under map phase and Redis phase. Okay, let me explain on a high level. Okay, how map Redis works. Okay. Okay, so as soon as we submit the job in Hadoop cluster, so the client will compute the input split. I'm going to explain, okay, in what is input split in detail. Client will compute the input split. Okay, for each input split, one map task will be launched. For each input split, one map task launched. Okay, and record reader is responsible for, there is something called record reader, responsible for reading the data from blocks based on the information from the input split. Information based on okay. Now each map task will receive the records in a key value pair. and produces the output in a key value pair. Okay, and reduces receive the data from each map task in a key value pair. And reducer produces the final output. Okay. Yeah, so as soon as you submit the job in the cluster, so the client computes the input split. Okay, so for each input split, one map task will be launched. So for example, let's say the client has computed four input splits. That means then four map tasks will be launched in parallel. Okay, and each map task will receive the record from the record header in a key value pair. Okay, so I'll explain what is input split in detail. Okay, each map task will receive the record in a key value pair and produces the output in a key value pair. So from here, the reduce method will receive that record. Basically, the output of the map method will be input to the reduce method. Okay, so reduce method will receive the data in a key value pair and produces the final output. Okay, so what is key value, what is input split? Right, so input split is nothing but a logical division of data. Okay, we have already discussed block split, right? Block split is a physical division of data. Block is nothing but it is used for holding the data, right? So block split, input split. So block split is a physical division of data. And this is logical division of. So what does that mean? You know, physical. Okay, block. This is in data is stored in the block only, right? In all the data nodes. Okay. So what does that mean? Input state. Okay. What are you referring to? This logical division of data. Okay. So logical division is nothing but just a metadata about the data. Metadata about the data. Basically, the particular block. Okay, let me give some example. Say, for example, somebody asked about this input split during HTFS class, right? Let's say, basically, MapReduce uses the input split to process the data. Okay, I have 256, 256, 512, and 513. Okay, so this is 512, this is 512, and this is something, let's say, find a find 5 KB. Okay, here let me assume that a file called customer.txt. okay, remember MapReduce is designed to process the data line by line. Okay, you can configure it, okay, how it has to process. It can process the XML file, it can process sequence file, it can process arrow file, it can process text file. Okay, with respect to text file, it will process the records line by line. Remember, like we talked about, right, different records. Let's assume that I have records 1, 2, 3, 4, and the fifth record. Remember, 256. 256 MB. So each block size is 256 MB. The final block size is 0.5 KB. That means the total file size is 512.5 MB. Right? Now, if you copy this 512.5 MB file into the Hadoop cluster, it will be broken into three blocks. Okay? So now first block occupies 256 MB. Second block occupies 256 MB. Third block occupies only 0.5 KB. Okay, now as I said, we have a five records in the first block, and you cannot guarantee that the fifth record will be complete one. Okay, it might be incomplete. Okay, say for example, up to these four and a half records, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, right? The fifth record is split into two blocks. Block 1 and block 2. That means the partial record of the fifth record will be stored here also. Let's say from this point, there's 256 MB. You cannot store beyond 256 MB because that's how you have configured, right? You have configured each block size is 256 MB. Let's say this 4.5 records already occupied 256 MB. That means the fifth record is broken into two blocks. Okay, the first half of the records is stored in block 1 and the remaining records is stored in block 2. Okay, again the sixth record is starting here. Again, fifth record is partial record is here, sixth record starts here, seventh record, eighth record, and let us assume that ninth record is broken into these two blocks. Okay, partial records are here and partial records are here. Okay, that means fifth record is incomplete in the block 1. The half of the records are stored in block 1 and block 2. Similarly, in the block 2, the ninth record is stored in block 2 as well as block 3. Because here, this 6, 7, 8 and ninth of half of the ninth records occupies the total 256 MB. Okay, just assume that. Okay, 99% of the time, this will be the case. Okay, when you record, when you store the records in the Hadoop systems. Okay. Now, how the input split will be computed by the client? Okay, now I want to find out the records belong to Sai, right? Let's say here I have Sai records 1 and fifth record is Sai record. And ninth record is Sai record. Okay, remember I told you, right? Mapper is process the record line by line. It will start processing the first record. Okay, so this record is complete one. Okay, it will retrieve one record. It will try to process the second record. It does not belong to Sai. It will skip. It will try to complete the third block, third row. It's not. It does not belong to Sai. It will skip. It will skip, and it will try to process the fifth block. Okay, but the block is in, the data is incomplete because this the fifth record is broken into two blocks. The first half is stored in block 1 and second half is stored in block 2. That means MapReduce cannot process this data, right? It cannot process the data. It will throw exception. Same cases, okay? It will skip this and it will see, okay, 9th record is the Sai record, but it cannot process because the record is incomplete, okay? So that's the reason, you know, MapReduce goes, you know, computes the input feed in a logical way. Basically, MapReduce process the record in a logical way. So, whenever we store the data, right, the block knows where the record begins. Okay, where the first record begins. Okay, beginning of the record. Of the record and where the record ends. Okay, here if you say, right, here the fifth record is incomplete. Okay, it is complete here only. Okay, now what happened is when the MapReduce computes the input state, it will, you know, take all the data along with this one. Because block internally maintains where the first block starts and where the end block, the last record ends. Okay, so the last record ends in the second block, right? So it will, okay, the starting byte offset will be 0 and ending byte offset will be, let's say 1000 something. Okay. Similarly, so when it try, it will compute the first input state. First input state. Okay. And when it will try to compute the second input state. Okay. It will start here. It will check whether this is the starting record. Not really. This is the partial record belongs to the previous block. Okay. So it will ignore this one. Then again, it will go to the second line. It will check. Okay, yeah, this is the beginning record. Okay, so the, when the client computes the second input state, it will start from the sixth record and it will end here. Okay, now even though we have three blocks, only two input state will be computed. Okay, and for each input state, one map task will be launched. That means two map tasks will be launched here. So that's why I said. Input state is a logical division of data. Clear or confusing?
So you are saying if we know which record or which particular attribute is to be split, so based on that, that will be the key, and based on the logical separation of data, that new number of input splits will be created.
No, I'm not talking about anything key or value here. Okay, this is something you know. Only the input state. Okay, let me explain. Okay, what are the information called story in input state? Okay, so in a particular input state, okay, address of the node, where the address of the data node where the block resides. That is basically block information. Okay, let's say this is the first input state. Okay, and this is the second input state. Okay, in the first input state, this will be the okay address of the node. What is this block one? Where it is data node one. Okay, that means it will have data node one. Okay, okay. Then the second information is okay. How much of byte they have to process? Okay, the starting byte offset will be zero. So data will be converted into bytes, right? Data will be stored in the bytes, right? So the starting byte offset will be zero and ending will be 1000. That means it has to process 1000 bytes. Yeah, and okay, where does all these 1000 bytes split across? Okay, these 1000 bytes are stored in block 1 and block 2, because block 2 has some partial record of 51, right? So it has second of the fifth record. So that's why it will have block 1 and block 2. So address of the data node 1 and address of the data node 2, right? So it will, okay, when this in map of start side, so this input will start reading the records from 0 here, and it will start go here. Here, let's say for some reason we have only 950 bytes. Okay, it will, but here it has to read 1000 bytes. So what it will do is it will read the remaining 50 bytes from here.
Okay.
Is it clear now? Okay, sure. And the input split 2. Okay, now when it comes to here, right, again it will store address of the node that holds the block. Okay, so let us say address of the node is data node 2. Okay, and where it has to start? Okay, it has to start from here, 0. Okay, and end something here, something 1000. I'm just giving some random numbers, 1000 bytes, it can be anything. Okay, it has to start from 0 and 1000. Right, so it has to process 1000 bytes. That means it will try to retrieve this 1000 bytes from here. It will not be there. Okay, it will automatically go to this block, third block. It will go to this block and read the remaining bytes. Okay, now it will have 1000 bytes to process the data. Now that here the block 2 is stored in data node 2 and data node 3. Okay, so this input state we have the metadata of address of the node that holds the block, as well as the amount of data it has to process.
Right, so I understand that 1000, that number that you gave was a random one. So, but in reality, in practical, what will be the actual size? What will that value be referred from basically? So,
okay,
is
in a reality,
size of the data that we are processing.
Again, in a reality, it depends on the data that occupies 256 MB. Let's say around 500K occupies 256 MB, and the last record from this 500 might be broken into another block. or sometimes exactly, but that is rare case. We cannot guarantee that, you know, that one block will hold exact 500 records. Definitely for 100%, you know, or 99.9%, the last record will be broken into another record. That means half of the records will be not exactly half of the records. Sometimes, let's say, you have a name, age, city, sorry, company, gender, and address. Okay, so all these information, a name, age, employer, gender, might be stored in the block one. Okay, in this first block. Okay, this alone, the address part alone, might be stored in the another block, or even this part, half of this address might be stored. All this records might be stored in the block one, and this part alone might be stored in the block two.
Okay.
Okay. This is the reality.
So Prakash, usually we cannot expect all the data should be in an you know, of particular record should be in a single line. So it might start with a name, and then it might have some, you know, like say it started with a name and it has some, got some personal details separated by spaces. Okay. And then on the same line, it can start with another name. So how it can find out which is the logical separation then?
Maybe I didn't get you. We are saying the partial records are stored in the block one, and the rest of the
Sorry to interrupt you. Let me tell you, like, no, so it started with name Sai, okay, Sai, and then my personal details, and say like my subjects, like I have marks across my subjects, okay, so that came in the first line. So on the same line, it might start with the second student, right? It might start with Prakash, like say again tab space, and then it started with Prakash. So here it's not an there is no separation. So you can say that by looking at the file, but the process may not identify to identify the broken record.
No, it can identify the broken record. That's what I am telling you, right? The client, when it starts computing the input speed, right, it will go by block, okay, block by block, okay. It will try to come, let's say. We have first block and we have second block, right? It will try to compute the first input speed for the first block. Okay, it knows, it will first check whether the block starts from here. Okay, definitely in the first block the records will be starting from here only, 0 byte. Okay, it will go, okay, no problem. And it will also check whether the last record is complete or not. Okay. It will check, because the block, basically this block will have maintain a hidden flag, okay, where it will have whether the record is complete or broken into another block. Okay, it will check, okay, the record.
Yeah, that's right, Prakash. So the records are not, you know, the whole record is not in a single line. So the record is followed by end of, you know, when a particular record ends, the second one starts. So we don't have any logical separation now. So how can the process can find itself where the record has been broken?
Okay, let's start in this way. Okay,
one more thing. So does the map? So does the number of map process is proportional? Sorry, is the map number of map processes are proportional to number of nodes or number of
input splits? Number of map tasks will be determined based on number of input splits. Say for example, if you have 5 input splits, then 5 map tasks will be launched. This is the thumb rule. Okay, but number of input splits may or may not be based on the number of blocks.
Okay.
Got it? See, remember in my previous example, we had a 3 blocks. Even though we had a 3 blocks, only 2 input splits are computed. Right? See, that's all right. Yeah. Here the beginning record, okay, client knows, okay, where the record starts, the first record starts. Here it will know, okay, where the indicator will be the first record starts, okay, and it will check whether the last record is broken or not. Okay, there will be,
no, that,
okay, when it,
yeah, that, That's where I guess. So we know that the record has been broken into two, you know, two blocks, say. But how can you distinguish? The process can distinguish where the record starts and where the record ends. That's where my question
is. Yeah. So that is what, you know, this is, you know, automatically taken by the framework. Okay. Whenever we store, right, it will automatically store, okay, beginning of the record and end of the record. It will maintain the flag whether the final record is, you know, complete or not. It will have a hidden flag. It will have a hidden flag, basically whether the record is complete or not. Okay. So when the client computes the input, it will try to read whether the last record is complete or not from this flag. Okay, it will check, okay, the record is incomplete. Then it will try to read the remaining from the another block. Okay, and when it tries to compute the second input speed, it will check here, okay, whether this is the starting record or not. This is not the starting record, okay. So the beginning of the record starts here. Okay, let's say this is the fourth record, partial record here, show you. So the beginning of the record starts here. Okay, then it will start computing from the second gear. This is fifth record, sixth record, seventh record. That's what. So for each block, okay, the information will be maintained about the beginning of the block and end of the block. Got it? Hello?
Prakash, could you give us some more example by using some data, like name and age we are storing on the file? The name could need not to be exactly 20 characters for everybody, right? So let us say there is a 30 character name, then obviously, as you said, the record will be split across the blocks.
Okay, so, let me give some example. Okay, okay, let's assume that okay, so let's assume that this is a customer ID, name, okay, age, gender, address, employer, address to telephone number, email ID. Okay, so this is the record one. Okay, so this we have, this all the records, all the fields are stored in the block one. Okay, let's assume that this is the second record. So this information is also stored in the same block. This is the two, let's say the size of this block is 256 MB. Okay, so I'm just giving only two records for example. Okay, actually when I say 256 MB, there will be even 100 or 200K based on the field size. Okay, so say this the second record also has name, everything is there. The third record, okay, ID is there, name is there, age is there, gender is there, address is there, what do you call, what is this field? Okay, whatever. Okay, address one. Okay, let's say address one is split. Okay, so for example, let's say this is the address 975 Eastern Avenue, Somerset, New Jersey. Whatever the zip code, 75038 something. Okay, now let's say up to this portions, okay, this part, okay, are stored here, this one, up to this part stored here, and the zip from here, and the remaining thing, email ID, right, email, what is it called, telephone number, email ID, and the zip code are stored in another block. Let's say this is the second block. Okay, let's assume that we have this in this 750038 is stored here, and the telephone number, email ID stored here. Okay, then another record starts here. Okay, just ignore. Okay, in a block you not see this separation and all. Like here, let's say you have a fourth record and fifth record. These are stored properly here. And let's say this is occupied. These two records occupy around 200 MB. Okay. The total is 456 MB. Okay, if the default block size is 256 MB, then there will be two blocks. First block will occupy 256, second block will occupy 200 MB. Okay, now we have a record 1, 2, 3. Okay, but the third record, okay, is incomplete. Okay, it has only up to this level. Okay, it has the ID, name, age, gender, address, but in address, it has only up to state. Okay, the zip code is stored in another block, because up to this point only it, you know, it, let's say up to this level, okay, it has occupied 256. You cannot store beyond 256 in a single block, because the default block is 256. That means it cannot store beyond 256 MB since the last record is not incomplete. Okay, it is not the case. Even if the last record is incomplete, it will store how much it can. It can only store 256. That's the reason it has stored only up to this point level. Let's assume that up to this point, okay, it occupies 256 MB. Okay, the remaining records, okay, will be stored in the block 2. Okay, what are them? Okay, 7508, then telephone number and email ID. Okay, here when we store the data, okay, right, so the block, right, will have a metadata where the, you know, starting records beginning, okay, in which bytes offset, 0 bytes offset, okay, and where the where the last record end, it will check, okay, this is complete, this is complete, but this last record is incomplete, this is not in, okay, so it will not have a ending record flag here, instead it will store here. Okay, when the achiever stores the second block, right, it will check, okay, this is the broken record and this is from the previous block. Okay, it will not put the starting point here. Instead, it will put the starting point here.
Okay, so to read an input split, we are using this record reader class, right? So in such a way, while we are storing this information, what is the class which distinguishes the split?
Okay, by default, there are different type of input format. Okay, text input format. Default is the text input format. Okay, so in MapReduce, when you run the program, right, if you don't specify any input format, then it will be treated as text input format. In text input format, okay, the starting byte offset will be treated as key, the remaining entire lines will be treated as a value. Okay, so this will be the key starting byte offset, and the record line, entire line will be treated as a value. So this will be the starting byte offset. Sorry, my digital pen has some problem. Starting point, okay, starting byte offset. Okay, okay. So when you specify text input format, this will be the key. Okay, what is the key? 0 byting offset. Okay, and the value entire record. Okay, now record will read this whole line and it will send it to map method. Okay, so the map method will receive the record in a key value pair. Key is a 0 and the entire record, entire line will be the value. Okay. Next, when the record reader reads the data, right, it will start from here. Okay, here the starting byte offset will be maybe 30 or something. Okay, we have a lot of fields, maybe 150. Okay, 150 to some numbers will be here, 150 to, let's say, 256. Okay, and again, so the input text input format, it will, the record reader will read the another record, starting byte offset will be, key will be 150, and the value will be entire record, entire line of the record. Okay, and it will try to read from here. Okay, when it tries to read, starting byte offset will be 257, right? Then third record will go 257, comma entire record. But here again, I told you, right, this will not have the complete value. So the input split will have that information about the broken record. It will tell, okay, this, the record is broken into another block. It will also hold the address of the second address of the node which has the block, right? It will go here. So it will try to give pass of the 256 as the key and the entire line, this one, from here, and the first line from the another block will be given as a value, the entire line, right?
So Prakash, here the entire block ends in email, not in the address, right? Because in the third record, if you see, address is only split. So it will not consider till the end of the address, no, it will consider till the end of the email only, right?
Yeah, because it is stored in the other block.
Actually, my doubt is address is only split into two. So the end of the address will be considered the end of the record here, or the end of the email will be considered?
The end of the email will be considered the complete
end of the record. Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Okay, so while it tries to read the input split, it will try to, so in this case, it will try to read both the blocks, block 1 and block 2, and in block 2, it will read only till the whatever record it was, whatever not full record, which is the last record of the first block. When it completes on the second block, it will read till that point, and then the map task will not proceed on this block. Is it?
I'm extremely sorry. Actually, come in, Guru, because I'm suffocating here because my AC is not working. So
okay. So while the, so in this case, the record is broken into block 1 and block 2, right?
Right. Okay.
So while the map task tries to read both, read this input split for the last record, it has to read both the blocks, block 1 and block 2.
Correct. Exactly.
So on
it
the
has
block
to read the data from the block 1 as well as in the block 2, from record from the block 2.
Okay, so on block 2, while it process, it will process only till that record, it finds that data for that record which has been broken, and after that it will not proceed. Is it right?
Yes, the first input split will process up to the broken record. Okay, that's why it composes the second input split. So if the second input split will start from the fourth record, it will skip the first line because it is the end of the record of the previous one. Right, so that's why it will skip the first record. It will it will mark as this is belong to the previous block record. So it will start from the fourth record.
Okay. So in that case, let us say there are two input splits. So in this case, the mapper which is processing for the second input split, it can run parallel and it will start from that.
From
the offset.
So before launching the map task, right, first step is the input split will be computed. Okay, basically the client will compute the input split. Okay, so remember I explained in detail, right, how the data is read in from the HDFS. Okay, so the client will talk to Namenode and it will get the list of blocks first. Okay, and it will also, the Namenode will return the address of the node that holds the blocks. Okay, here. Okay, let's assume that it has three blocks. Okay. So just assume that first block is has the complete records 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, it starts from the fifth record here, sixth record here, seventh record here, and the eighth record is split across two nodes in block 2 as well as block 3, meaning the 8th record is not complete here, it is stored here also. Okay, so this is block 1. Okay, when clients contact the name node will return all the address of the node. Okay, data node 1, let's assume that this is the data node 1, this is 2, and this is 3. Okay, it will return the address of the node that holds the block. Remember, do you guys remember, it will return like block 1 in data node 1, the replica also, forget about the replica here. Okay, forget about the replica, let's assume that it returns only 1. Okay, and it will return block 2 in data node 2 and block 3 in data node 3. So now the client, based on the input it has, based on the information it has received from the node, it will try to compute the input split. First, it will pick up the first block. Okay, then it will start computing. Okay, so it will go by line by line. sorry, just one second. Yeah, so it will go line by line. Okay, it will, when it tries to compute this input speed, all the cuts are complete. Okay, the first cuts are stored in the block 1, 2, 3, and 4th cuts are complete perfectly. I mean, this will not be in the this will not be the case in a real time. Definitely, you know, the last record will be broken into one or two, I mean, in another records. Okay, let's assume that for our example, the fourth record is completely stored here. Okay, now it will compute first input split. Okay, the inputs, this input split will have information like, okay, so it has to, the block, it has to process the block 1, which is stored in the data node 1. Then it will also have the information where to start 0 bytes and where to end 1000 bytes. So basically it has to have the information about the amount of space, amount of the data it has to process. Okay, so address of the node that holds the block data and amount of data it has to process. Okay, okay, second in, it will try to compute the second input split now. Okay, so when it tries to read line by line, fifth record, sixth record, seventh record is fine, but the eighth record is broken into one more block, right? The eighth record is incomplete in the block 2, okay, because the partial record is put in another block as well. So what it will do is, so it will check, okay, block, you know, for the second input split, okay, it has to read the data from block 2 and block 3, because the eighth record is broken into block 2 as well as block 3. So that's why it will hold the information like block, it has to read the data from block 1 and block 2, which is stored in the data node 2, this is stored in the data node 3. Okay, the next information is where it has to start. Okay, okay, starting byte offset, let's say 0. Okay, and the ending byte offset value will be something like here, let's say this is ends here, okay, and another 1000. I'm just giving some random number, okay. It will have, it has to start from the 0 and it has to end with the 0. Right now, so it has computed the second input speed. Now it will try to compute the third input speed. Okay, it will go here. Okay, okay, it will try to compute the, whether it will check whether this is the beginning of the record. Not really, this is the broken record. Okay, this record belongs to the eighth one. Right, then it will try to read the second, another line, but there is no record here. So it will skip. So that means even though we have a three blocks here, only two input split will be computed. So this two input split is nothing but just a metadata about the data. Okay, it has only the block information and amount of data it has to process. So okay, address of the node that holds the red block and amount of the data, where to start, where to end. Okay, so only these two information will be stored in the input split. Okay, so once this input split is computed, okay, this will be given to, this will be copied into the HTFS. Okay, I'll explain that in detail. Okay, is this clear now how the input split is computed now?
Yeah, yes, Prakash.
Prakash, okay. It's the same question what I asked. How the system, the input split, right, knows this is the delimiter of the particular record. We are talking about the block and everything is fine, but for a particular record, how we will know this is the starting point of the record and this is the thing, because it will be like a tab or something where normally the file will be. So how it will know?
Yeah, so that's what, this is a good question. Okay, okay, when you write MapReduce program, you have to specify, okay, the delimiter, how the records are delimited, right? Whether it's a comma separated or it's a tab delimiter or it's in a del delimiter or a, semicolon, whatever it is, okay, how the records are, how the fields are delimited, you have to specify. Okay, if you don't specify, it will assume that the records are delimited by comma, I guess, comma or space, I think space, sorry, I don't remember exactly, maybe I'll check it out and get back to you, okay. It's been long time since I took this one, okay.
Okay, and where this has been?
Okay, now it will, let's say this records are stored here, right? You have an employee ID and a comma separator, a name ABC, address something 575 Eastern Avenue, comma, okay, email ID, something like a.am, okay, something at, right? here the let's say here you need to have this email ID is incomplete. Okay, actual email ID is Prakhi.am. Prakhi.am@gmail.com is the complete email ID. But here it split the last record. Assume that this this eighth record, okay, has employee ID, name, address, and the email address. But this is not complete. Okay, you don't find the comma separated here. Okay, instead it will be in another another block. Okay, let's say here. Let's assume that this has records like this, and this has record like this. Here, just assume that only we have the text Prakhi. Okay, now here it will start with am@gmail.com, right? Comma, and what else field? Okay, gender, m, and telephone number, something 475, etc. And okay, lines are delimited by new line. Okay, lines are separated by new line. Okay, so that's the default one, right? Now when it tries to compute the input speed, right, how it computes the input speed based on the input information you have given when you write the MapReduce or when you submit those input as an arguments. Okay, you will specify whether this comma separated or not, right? If you have specified comma separated, okay, it will try to compute the input speed. The client will compute the input speed based on the information you have given. You need to understand that. Okay, now it will try to read the eighth record, comma delimited, right? Here it will not find out. Okay, something is broken. Okay, it will, okay, it will, that's why it will go to the another block to read that. It will always check, you know, check whether the next block has the broken record. Okay, it will go here and it will, okay, the broken record is stored in the another block. So that's how it computes the input speed. Clear? It will also, that's why it has the indicator. Okay, this is the, it is not, this is a broken record, it doesn't have the complete record.
So Prakash, do we specify the line, sorry, record delimiter and as well the field delimiter of the record as well? Do we have to specify the
field? Yes, we have to specify, right? So the default is text input format, okay? In the text input format, key will be the starting value of the, and the input format will be comma separated, I guess. Yeah, I think comma is the default one. I'll confirm you, okay?
Yeah.
Once again, let me check here.
And Prakash, this input split information will also be saved as part of the metadata. Is that a correct statement?
This input split not part of the metadata. No. This input split will be computed only when you run the jobs. This will not be stored upfront.
Okay, so only while we read the data, this will be computed then, right?
Correct. Yeah, only when you run the jobs. It will be computed. So the input speed is temporary. Okay, it will be computed and it will be alive until the job runs. Once the job gets over, then this will be removed from the cluster. This will be stored in the temporary HDFS location. Okay, so you said job class, output class, file input format. Okay, so the default input format is the text input format. Okay, I think the default is since you are using file input format, with any deal, it's up to the mapper to spin the. No, actually, I'll get you that one. Okay.
I forgot that. Line split is new line character.
No, I'm talking about the.
Oh, about the individual, the record split?
Yeah, so here, right, thing is, It will read the data in the key value pair only. Okay, as I told, right, we have different input format, text input format, inline input format, key value text input format, sequence file input format, DB input format, whole thing. So in text input format, right, what happens is it will read, okay, 0 is the key, okay, and the entire line will be the value. Again here, the starting byte offset will be something, okay, that will be the key, that the entire line will be the value, same for everything, okay. In n line input format, right, instead of single line, you can process even four lines, okay. For example, when you specify a four, right, in n value text input format, it will take here the zero as the starting answer, then four records will be given as my value to the record reader. So that's how record reader will read from the block. Okay, so basically record reader will will use the reference from the input speed, where to start and where to end, okay, and also it will reference, okay, where the data are stored, okay. Input speed will tell, okay, this particular data are stored in block 1 and stored in data node 2 something, okay. Then record reader will go there, and it will record reader will know, okay, how to read the records. Because we are going to specify whether it's the text input format or anything. Here we'll specify job dot input format equal to text input format dot class. So here, if you see, right, so if you don't specify, okay, the default will be the text input format class. If you don't specify here, clear?
Prakash, one more thing. So unless the record is broken, the block size would be same as the split size, is that so?
Unless the broker record is broken, the split is, yeah. So for example, let's say we have two blocks, okay. Record one, record two, record three. 1, 2, 3, and let's assume that the record three is complete one, okay. All the fields belong to record 3 are stored in block 1, and it starts from here, record 4 and 5. I think that this also, the fifth record is also stored completely in block 2. Now if you see here, right, there will be two input split, first input split here and second input split here. So this one map task will be launched to process all the records which are stored in this block, and the another map task will be launched to store the process all the records stored here. Okay, so there won't be, this map will not read any record from here, because all the records are complete here, completely. The records are completely stored in block 1 itself. This input split will try to, get the data from here only when the last record is broken. Otherwise, it will not go to another block.
No, Prakash, my doubt is the size of the split.
Size of the split, what do you mean?
So, I mean, in this case, as the records are not broken across the blocks, so the input size is same as the is same as that of block size, right?
Yeah, it can be. Okay, let's say this will be 256, and this might be 200 something.
Now, if the record is, like, say, in the first block, if the record has been broken at, and then it is followed, followed in the second block. Now the input size of the split may not be the block size, because it has to continue the broken record out of the.
Correct. That's what I told you, right? Okay. Remember, I told you, right? When Arvind asked one question at the beginning of the class, okay? So one map task might process more than 256. In this cases, right? Here, let's say first record, second record, third record. Third record is broken into block 1 and block 2. If that is the case, so the input speed will process 256 plus the broken one. It may be, let's say, 4 KB something. Okay, that means 256.4 KB. The first input speed will process 256.4 KB. The second will process 200 MB minus 4 KB something. Okay, then remaining will be processed by this one.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Any questions in this input space concept? See, very simple. Okay, I told you, right? MapReduce will process the record line by line. Here the line, if we have the indicator, okay, new line terminated, right? Terminated by the line terminated by new line, right? Okay, it will check whether the line is properly terminated. Not the last record is not terminated properly. It has broken. Okay, the second bar has the continuation of third record. That's why it will. That's how it will identify how the records are broken into another block.
Just okay. One last question.
Yeah.
Suppose if the first block is split into two. No, suppose the last record of the first block is split into the second thing. So the input split will be like there will be three input splits, right? Suppose first block is having two records and the third record is broken into the second thing, and the second block is having fourth and fifth record. So in that case, there will be totally of two input splits, right?
Yeah, only two input splits. The first input split will process first record, second record, third record. First, it will also read the sum of the records from the block 2, because third record is split into two blocks, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Then second input split will process the fourth and fifth record.
Okay. So till the place where it is broken, one input split will take care. From the next, again, second input split will come.
Correct. Exactly.
Yeah, okay, that's
okay. Any other question?
Prakash, and a general thing, I had some few doubts in Linux. When I practiced, I just dropped you a mail actually.
Oh, maybe when did you send a mail? Can you send it to my personal ID?
Okay, guys. Okay. Send it to info at
InSetis. You can use my personal ID. This is my personal ID. Prakash.am@gmail.com.
Okay.
You can, any questions, you can send it to this one.
Okay. Prakash, and one more thing. So, when I want to practice some HDFS commands, so where I should go, like to which directory I should go and start executing the commands?
You can run it from anywhere. You can just open the terminal. Remember, okay. We have set the home environment variable, right? So even if you run Hadoop commands from anywhere, Linux can understand what the command is, right? So that's why we set the environment variable in the bash or C file. You can run it from anywhere, but you need to make sure all the daemons are running, up and running. So you have to start the services before you run HDFS command. Otherwise,
so
you'll get
Already we have configured all the daemons, so directly I can go and start with start-all.sh and put jpg at least start running the start writing the commands, no?
Correct. Yeah.
Okay, Prakash, thanks.
Are you guys clear on the input split concept? Or kind of confusing?
Yeah. I am clear.
How about others?
Yeah.
Jata, Shyam.
Yeah, Prakash. So far I'm okay. But still I couldn't relate with the real time, but as a theoretical
concept. I will talk about that. Yeah.
I'm okay with the theoretical concept.
Okay.
Only the delimiter we had a doubt, so that is clarified, yeah. Where it how it identifies where it starts, where it ends and all. So yeah, that delimiter thing we understood.
Okay, so anything?
Prakash, actually, can HDFS, in Hadoop, can process like EBCAC data, like FDR, like COBOL related data, which is from the mainframes, right?
Yeah, can you can write a program in COBOL to process the data which is stored in the HDFS. That's what you can come up with your new programming language to process
no,
the data.
File format, right? No, currently it is in a readable format, the file. Actually, if you see, like, there are some files which will be not in a ASCII format. It is like another EBCDIC data.
We need to specify the type of file, okay? How to, whether it's a text file or whether it's a CSV file or whether it's a sequence file. We have to specify, right? Only the supported file will be processed in a C++.
Okay, it should be in an ASCII form. If it is in a binary form, it won't accept.
Yeah, you can store the binary data in the name in the form of sequence file. In fact, a sequence file can sequence file is mainly designed for that only. Okay, you can store the binary data in a sequence file because it doesn't make sense to store the binary data in the text file, right? So that's why you need to have some specialized file type which can store the binary data. So that is where the sequence file all comes into the picture. Okay, you can make use of sequence file. You can store a sequence file in HDFS if you have the binary data and process that one. Basically, it has extension .seq, like a TXT, right? Text file. See, this one, what do you call it? CSV, TXT.
Ravesh, we can process the binary format file.
Yeah, you can process binary data. You can process binary data.
Because in my previous project, I remember one of the source feed is a binary formatted file. They convert the binary format into text format and then only they do the processing. That's why I was wondering.
Yeah, that's if they can store that data in a sequence file, they can do the processing. Or at least in the text file, they can do that. With the direct different extension, they can have to process.
Because see, when only you store a binary formatted file in HDFS, how will you read and access it?
Sorry?
When you store a binary formatted file in HDFS, how will you read and access the data?
Let's say you have stored as a .sq sequence file, okay? Then you can use the command of Hadoop. Instead of cat, right, you will say Hadoop space fs hyphen text. Then you will give the binary file extension, complete line. Okay, then it will read the binary data, give you the output.
Okay. Let me try out.
You can store the file as a sequence file, then try to read using that text command. That is one cloud certification question.
Sorry, no. What is the question?
How do you read the sequence file in HDFS? So there will be multiple options. So you have to select a Hadoop. First is text. Instead of cat, we have to use text and the path and the file sequence file. SQ. You can read the binary sequence file using the text command.
Okay, sequence instead of putting cat, we should just write okay text.
Yeah, text TEXT.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can use that one.
Prakash, in the practical sessions, are you going to show us the different kinds of format processing the input files other than the
right,
the normal word count?
Right. Yeah. I'll be saying that. So in the part one, we'll not be having any exercise. In part two, I'll be going over all these exercises. Okay. Write simple map reduce and we'll go with one use case of how to find some trending words in Twitter or whatever. I'll just run one example and I'll explain the different components in detail, like the partition, compiler, sorting, spilling, etc., shuffle phase, everything. So I'm just giving some high level idea.
Okay. So and one more thing, so if reduce runs in each node, so like who is going to aggregate all the data from across the nodes? So is there any process after reduce?
No, before the reduce, when the reduce phase starts, right, see there is a difference, okay. Under reduce phase, we have a different stages, shuffle, sort, merge, and then reduce method, okay. So before reduce method gets triggered, you know, we have a shuffle and sort merge, right. So these stages, this process will be started, okay. So shuffle is responsible for transferring the data from all map tasks to reducer node.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so shuffle will take care of transferring the data from the map mappers node to reducer node.
Okay. So then in this case, who is going to combine all the data from to form an output from all the nodes?
That's all right. Shuffle will take the data from all the map and give it to reduce method. Reduce method, yeah, will combine the results.
No, but okay. So, but reduce, you said reduce runs in each node.
No, no. Reduce will not run in each node. Only map task will run in each node or wherever the block is there. Okay. Reduce will be launched in one places. Okay. See, reducers, number of reducers can be specified. Okay. The default is one. If you want, you can have more than one reducer. Say, for example, let's say I have a customer data, okay, belongs to different city. Say, for example, Chennai, Bangalore, right? So, but I want to store this Chennai and Bangalore data in a different file. That means you need to have a two reducers. So, for each reducer, one output will be there. One output file will be there. So, when you switch to two reducers, then two output will be there. So, one output file will have the records belong to Chennai. Another output will have the record belongs to Bangalore.
Okay.
So in real time, mostly you will go with only one reducer. Yeah, okay, Ram. Okay, any other question, guys? Sorry, guys, I'm not able to sit. Actually, I have switched off my AC since I'm not feeling well. That's why.
Yeah, any thank question? You, Prakash. We will see tomorrow because you already on my next time. So thank you for your patience and dedication. Thank you.
Okay, guys, we'll meet tomorrow. Okay, sorry, guys.
Yeah, okay, take care. Thank you.